Hi, I'm Tamara, and this is TELUS Talks with Tamara Taggart. Hi, everyone. Today, we are speaking with Charmaine Hammond and Michael Mankowski, who are the executive producer and filmmaker of Back Home Again. It's an animated short film based on the 2016 Fort McMurray forest fires. The film premiered this fall at the Edmonton International Film Festival and won the Jury Award for Best Animation Short. Charmaine and Michael, it's really good to see you. Thank you so much for being here.
Oh, thanks for having us on.
Thank you.
Yeah, so I guess we should start, Michael, with this is kind of your baby, right? I guess that's the best way to describe it. This film is your baby. And how did this come about? What is the film, I guess, why did you want to make this film?
Yeah, I was evacuated in 2016. Like many people in Fort McMurray, I was born and raised there and ran my business there. And I was affected by the wildfire. And shortly after, I was given the opportunity to be one of the first people to re-enter the community and work with the Red Cross. And I worked with them during the re-entry, the 1 year and the 2 year anniversary, and recorded over 200 testimonials of people affected by wildfires. And ultimately, I wanted to create a film or a tool that could be used to create awareness for mental health and help my community. And it just started off just with that intention.
So Charmaine, how did you and Michael connect?
I love sharing this story. I'm glad you asked. I actually lived in Fort McMurray for just under 16 years, not at the time of the fires, but after the fires, I was brought back to the community through the school boards and some of the social profit organizations to do some work around resilience and recovery and helping the nonprofits go through this journey of recovery. And while I was there, everyone kept saying, you've got to talk to this Michael Mankowski. He's got this amazing screenplay. And Charmaine, you're really passionate about mental health. I worked in that arena for many years. And you love projects that matter. And I met Michael. We went out for a bite to eat and had a conversation. And 15 minutes in, I had, you know, heck yes, count me in. I don't know what this looks like, but this project matters.
Those are usually the best partnerships when it's like you get excited about something. You're not sure how it's going to look when it all ends, but you just know, right?
Yes.
And it sounds like you two just knew once you met each other.
Definitely.
Yes.
Yeah.
Okay, so there's a lot of talent besides the two of you, a lot of talent in this film. So your voice actors. I mean, yeah. Give us some of the names, Michael. This is impressive.
Yeah, we have Jeremy Renner, Kim Basinger, Eugene Levy, Catherine O'Hare, Michael J. Fox, Ed Asner, Norm MacDonald, Gordon Pinson, Tamina Savari, Tantu Cardinal, Lauren Cardinal, Bill Burr, Scott Thompson, Tom Green, Harlan Williams. Marlon Wayans, Sherry Shepherd. Just an incredible, Howie Mandel, just incredible group of voice actors and talent that came together to do this film. I've been told it's the largest ensemble of award-winning actors in a short film.
Yeah.
We just
lost Norm MacDonald.
Yes.
And Ed Asner.
Yeah.
Also passed away not long ago. And so this is a real, almost like... it's just so special that they're included in this film, really.
Oh, so much. They're both heroes of mine. Like, getting a chance to work with Ed was just such an incredible opportunity. And he was just so kind to me and, like, motivational early on because, you know, I was in film school during this time and I'm flying out to meet Ed and just, you know, just a lot of belief in this early project because at this time, too, I hadn't met Mark DePay, the producer, that would eventually help me pull this together. And mostly I just had storyboards and a dream. And Norm MacDonald is someone I've idolized my whole life. The only video, like movie that I keep with me all these years is an old VHS copy of Dirty Work. And I've just loved that man so much. And to get a chance to work with him and all of these actors is just a dream come true.
So who was the first voice actor that you signed?
Yeah, so Tom Green. So I had a relationship with Tom Green prior to the wildfire. And I was actually... I just won an award and raised some money to make my first feature film, which was going to star Tom. And we were gearing up to do that. And I was actually on the line getting ready to shoot the day I was evacuated from the from my community. I say the forest. And then that opportunity was taken away from me. And shortly after that, longtime friend and producing partner of Tom, John Schneider, Rob's brother, he reached out just to check in on me and see how I was doing. And, you know, that day I asked him, like, is there any chance Tom would be the first to record a voice for this? And, you know, he was kind enough to say, I'm not sure, but I'll ask. And slowly we just continued asking for years until we assembled this cast. And, you know, everyone really, the shared experience of what happened in the Malibu wildfires really brought this together.
Mm-hmm. I think, you know, Charmaine, when you look at the storyline of this film, and with Michael mentioning Malibu, and here in British Columbia, we have Lytton, BC, that the whole town burned this past summer. This is not, I mean, it's a horrific thing what happened, but we're hearing about it more and more, aren't we?
We are, and one of the challenges that, you know, with Fort McMurray, Michael always talks about the fact that there was the downturn in the economy, and then there was the forest fires, then there was the flood, and then there's this pandemic. And the pandemic is actually a shared experience that we are all facing around the world, and it's heightened the mental health issues. Canadian Mental Health has shared that many times around the increase in mental health issues, the decrease in resilience. And so with some of the disasters and crisis that are happening around the world, that was a big part of this movie, was to create a resource, a tool that could actually inspire conversations, to get people talking about mental health and to help people be connected to resources and support so that they can get the help that they need.
Yeah. And so, okay, I just need to, so this film took 5 years.
Yeah.
So did you meet at the beginning of this? You mean to tell me that you met, you had lunch, and then 5 years later you finished the film?
Yeah. I'd worked.
Wow.
I think I met Charmaine about a year into the project. But, you know, same with John Schneider, the producer who helped assemble the cast. And yeah, we've been working on this for 5 years, and everyone else kind of came in around a year into the project and has been working with me ever since. So it took like to pull off 30 minutes of animation without a studio is just an incredible challenge. And, you know, I would get quotes from animation studios in Canada ranging from like, I think the cheapest quote I got was about $560,000 for 20 minutes of animation, ranging all the way up to $1.2 million. So, you know, this is technically you're making like a pilot episode of television. And, you know, also you have a responsibility to produce something that is high quality because all these actors have now given their voice. So it's really, I ended up going to animation school and selling my home and going to animation school to pull this off. I quickly realized that this is, you know, I started this with a 10-minute script, and I believed that we could do this in a year or two, and it was a small project. But while working with all our partners, like CMHA and everyone, we kept making a longer movie because we wanted to better represent our community. And then by the end of it, we had made a 30-minute film, and, you know, it became so hard to produce that ultimately I had to go to school to do this and try and enlist everyone I know.
Oh my gosh. Okay, wait. So wow.
Yeah, I never studied animation. I was like a live action filmmaker, mostly doing documentary work and short films and a lot of corporate videos. And I had a passion for animation my whole life, but I never thought I would become an animator or, you know, even start drawing or do any of this. But I really jumped into the deep end. I didn't realize how much work this would take. So.
Yeah, I'm glad that you can smile about it now, because it's pretty incredible that, I mean, you sold your house and you went and learned how to do it.
Yeah.
My gosh. So this, I mean, I don't even know if you can call it, like, it's more than a passion project. Yeah. It's consumed
my life for 5 years. This is all I do.
Yes.
Is think, you know, about this and work on this every day, and just trying to refine my skill to the point where I could get professionals in the industry to come work with me. And it was a long journey.
What a love letter to your hometown, you know?
So, you know, very much so. That's actually what I like to refer it as. You know, Fort McMurray supported me for many years as I worked on my skills as a filmmaker and gave me the opportunity even to buy that home or call myself a professional filmmaker. So I love that town. I love all the people that supported me over the years. And honestly, I was struggling during the wildfire. It was a very hard time for me because now I felt like I just finally get a chance to make a feature film with someone I idolize, Tom Green. And then that opportunity is taken away from me. I had all these selfish feelings kind of like, how can this be happening to me? And ultimately, getting the chance to work with the Red Cross and record all these testimonials, I started healing through that process. And those selfish feelings I was having were going away. And, you know, you start to realize when you're talking to a teacher and all the classrooms gutted, or a young child and he's talking about losing his bedroom, or an Indigenous person talking about losing their way of life because they're not sure if the animals will come back. I just realized that I had a lot of powerful stories that I wanted to share.
That's really, really beautiful. And I think that maybe, Charmaine, when we, you know, people on the outside, maybe looking in, right, and seeing what happened on the news, or, yeah, you know, it's a minute 30 news story, mm-hmm, and you see it and then you carry on with your day because it doesn't affect most people in their day-to-day life, right? And so, I mean, this is really focused too on mental health and the importance of you know, how a horrific event has really challenged some people, and it doesn't go away when you turn off the TV. So you brought in a lot of professionals, didn't you, Charmaine?
Yeah, Michael and I worked together to bring in, there's a variety of professionals. So we had a number of educators work with us at different stages around the content and the script. We brought in about 20 different mental health professionals to be able to work with Michael and I around kind of the style of animation, the color, the colors, the language that we are using in the script. So Michael put so much incredible care into the development of the entire movie. And then, of course, bringing this movie to life has happened through collaborations and partnerships and sponsors and grants. And the Canadian Red Cross and Canadian Mental Health Association have played some really vital parts in this project. For example, Canadian Mental Health Association is working with us closely to create resources and educational tools so that when people watch this movie, because it was created to be watched with someone so that you could talk about it. So we have these tools, and Michael and the team are working on an app that will support people in those conversations and building resilience after they watch the movie.
Mm. And Michael, when you were, you know, recording testimonies from people and their stories, did you find that it put you more in tune with your own emotions around your loss and others and how you all, you know, in the same town but experiencing things maybe in different ways?
Yeah, I'm quite an emotional person just in general, and I would, like, every day I would film these testimonials, I would just cry with the person. Like, I know you're supposed to be like tough and do this, but I'm like the worst. I get more emotional even than the interviewee sometimes. And so it was a hard experience for me, but I definitely felt like I was life-changing, like in a way of just, it made me fall in love with the community. I felt like I was doing such great work. I felt, and the other thing that happened during that time is I ended up recording the majority of like community videos and news footage during that time. And I wouldn't have the chance to edit a lot of it, and it would go to publication, and I felt that my community wasn't represented properly. And I really struggled with that because I'm filming all these testimonials and doing all this work, and then I'm struggling with the way the stories they choose, you know, to pick and choose from. And I just didn't feel it was an accurate depiction of what was going on. So through that, I felt like kind of a responsibility to tell this story, actually.
Almost protective of your hometown.
Very much so, you know.
And the people who live there, right?
Well, without question, because I'd filmed some stories and then, you know, someone would come up to me and say, why wasn't I in that? Or what, you know, you'd film me or, and, you know, and so I really just tried to look back on that. You know, I started the film with a land acknowledgement. Me and Charmaine worked very hard to raise funds to put this in Cree and Dene translation. I really just wanted to make sure that we were doing this different and that Fort McMurray would be proud of this.
It's amazing. It really is. So you mentioned the Canadian Mental Health Association, both of you. You worked very closely with them. They do great work. We know that. And we, on this show, we like to give back to a Canadian charity that our guests choose for your time, for being here. So we will be giving the Canadian Mental Health Association $500 in your name that they can, you know, they can put to good use. And you know, I know there's a lot of need right now for so many people, especially as you mentioned with the pandemic, it's just added on top of, you know, all the stressors most people are carrying already. So when we look at this story that we now have out in the world, this love letter to Fort McMurray, what was it like the first time you saw it? You know, I want you both to answer this. So let's start with you, Michael. The first time you saw the film, it's done. I know you've seen it probably millions of times. Yeah. Every single second, you know it so intimately. But to actually sit down and watch it with maybe an audience, yeah, whether that's small or large, tell us about that.
So that was an amazing experience. I just got that opportunity to do that at the Edmonton International Film Festival, and we had five showings, and I sat in the back away from everyone, and I just would cry the whole time. Like, it's so emotional for me. Like, I can't believe that we even made this, honestly, that I got to work with all these people, it's consumed my life. So it's so hard to put into words, but to watch it and hear like the reactions and the laughs and hear other people crying and people coming up to me afterwards and telling me how much they enjoyed the film. It was a very emotional weekend, but it was amazing.
Charmaine, how was it for you?
Well, I might just start bawling right now with as I answer that. I'm with Michael. So we didn't sit together in the film festival. We sat apart, and I just remember as soon as the music came on and I'm watching on the big screen, of course, I'd seen it on my computer many times, and it was the first time. And Michael was really clear on that. He said, the first time you've got to see it, it's when, you know, when we actually launch it on the big screen. So, and the music came on, and I just felt this massive rush of goosebumps over my body. And that didn't go away for the whole movie. It was beautiful to watch. It was actually like I was watching a movie I hadn't seen before, and yet I watched it all the time. And I concur with you, Michael, listening to the people in the theater with us and their emotion and the comments afterwards and the questions. There were some students in the audience with their parents, and the questions that they were excited to ask Michael about. And that's exactly why this movie was created, was to start conversations and invite questions. And it happened right there at the first screening.
Wow. So, Michael, who is this movie for?
This is definitely for, I say, families. You know, we look at this as, this is a resource for children, but I think the way to start those conversations is through watching it with an adult or someone you're close with, so you can have those conversations afterwards. And that's why we're working hard to create the app as well that we'll release, which will go through and walk you through the movie and ask you questions on how you felt and retention on the film. And there's so many things we built in, like, you know, a mole character, how many times you see this, like even during some of the heavy questions, I try and come up with ways to maybe distract some of the younger children or ways to ease some of these heavy stories. And ultimately that's the reason we chose to do animation, is to take some of these heavy stories that I had, and with the use of animation, it kind of lightens them. And we can talk about this, I think, in a healthy way. And because, as Charmaine mentioned earlier, the COVID shared experience now, you know, when we started this, we couldn't even say mental health. We said PTSD. So we've come a long way in those 5 years about to be able to talk about mental health in a public space. I just recommend anyone to watch this with a family member or just a friend or someone close to them.
And Charmaine, you know, maybe somebody's listening to, you know, this conversation we're having right now, and they're thinking, oh, well, I don't really know anything, you know, about Fort McMurray. Don't know where that is. I don't know why I should watch this film. It's not really about that, is it?
Yeah, Michael always describes it beautifully. He says that this isn't a movie about a disaster. This is a movie about connection. and people coming together and coming home. It's a movie about hope and community. And there's so much research out there that says that what gets people through difficult times, including disasters, is the power of connection. And so our friends at Canadian Mental Health Association always remind us that it's okay not to be okay all the time, that we all go through things in life where we need support and connection. And that's really what we're hoping people will get from that movie and reach out and realize that they're not alone.
Yeah, the power of community,
yes,
if you will, right? The power of having, community care, responsibility for, our friends. And what are your dreams, Michael, now that I know it's probably everything surreal to you now that you're done, and it's really not done because you still have a lot of work to do. You need to get this movie, we need to get lots of people watching this movie so they have a better understanding of like we said, the importance of community and moving forward and supporting each other. So what are your dreams? What are you excited about?
Well, I'm excited to release this over the next year and roll this out and get as many eyes on this as possible. And in a dream world, I'd love to find a broadcast partner, like someone like, the CBC or, something like that, to release this and create awareness on, maybe Emergency Preparedness Day or World Mental Health Day and talk about this every year. I hope to inspire other artists to, use their art for mental health or any way to make a difference in the world. Ultimately, that's what I want to do next and, do another short film or film that brings conversations to causes that are important to me, whether it be, the bees dying or racism or all sorts of, indigenous causes. I think there's endless stories we have, and I just hope to tell stories that matter.
Yeah. Well, storytelling is a true art, isn't it? And well, you're an animator now, Michael.
Yes. So I can just draw my own stories and that's the beauty of this. I learned a lot through this and I never thought I was always fascinated by this and I always looked up to all these artists. I never thought I would become one. So I was so grateful for my experience at Vancouver Film School and all the mentors I had through this.
It's pretty incredible. It's quite a story. I mean,
thank you.
It is. It really is. And I can see you when you said you were an emotional person. And I think you've talked about 5 or 6 times about, crying here, crying there. Yeah. And I can see it looking at you, right? I can see your emotion and how much this means to you. This story, I can see it and I can hear it in your voice. And I think that right there, artists don't always show that side of themselves. And I think it's really incredible that you have. And this obviously is a really special film. And the person who created it is obviously, very special for doing this in 5 years of your life, right? Charmaine, is this the kind of film like that we should be showing in every single school everywhere? Where should this be shown if somebody's listening?
Michael and I talk about this all the time. And one of our dreams is that people will watch the movie and have a conversation around the dinner table, that it will inspire conversations at home. And back to your question about schools, yes, that is so important to us that the film be available to schools so that teachers can watch that. They can create panel conversations, including community resources that come into the classroom or come into an all-student assembly, and as well as the organizations and first responders who make such a difference in our communities. They are the ones that keep people safe and keep people connected. So we're excited about being able to get the film out to those groups as well.
Yeah, it sounds perfect. I can't thank you both enough for joining us and letting us know about the movie, sharing your perspective and all your hard work, 5 years. I'm still not over the fact that you sold your house and went to animation school. It's That is commitment. That is deep love for your hometown. Truly, truly. So people can go to your website, right, to find out more about the movie. It is backhomeagainmovie.com. backhomeagainmovie.com. And you can also follow on Instagram or Facebook, which is at backhomeagainmovie. Anything else people should be looking up for, you know, that's coming up in the future? Or we just keep our eyes peeled for Back Home Again movie?
Yeah, we'll release our app, looking to release that in November. So that'll come out to support the film. And hopefully we have more news on where you can watch the film shortly.
Awesome. Thank you both again. Charmaine, thank you so much. Michael, thank you. Thank you. Yeah, really looking forward to watching this movie just shine and shine and shine. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thanks for listening to another episode of TELUS Talks with Tamara Taggart. Be sure to subscribe so you can join us every Tuesday for another conversation. You can also check out our website, telus.com/podcast, and subscribe to our YouTube channel at TELUS Talks.